Oh, I used to be a rounder, I've been around this town. Oh, I used to be a rounder, been around this town. I've courted pretty Polly, I've been all around. Oh, word is pretty Polly, oh, yonder she stands. Oh, word is pretty Polly, oh, yonder she stands. Gold dimes on her fingers and her little white.
Hey guys, welcome back to Mountain Murders. This is episode 7. And
you look a little confused.
Yes, we're back.
A little befuddled by your numbers today.
Yeah, well, you know, when it gets up to where I got to take my shoes off, you know.
Well, you only have 7 toes, so I guess we're fucked after this.
Yes.
Do you have a Jolly Rancher in your mouth?
No, I did.
Okay.
It's gone now.
Because that's like a number one rule of broadcasting. You shouldn't have something in your mouth. Like,
okay.
No candy, no gum, no dicks, you know.
Right.
Just to let you know.
Okay, well, I'll spit all that out.
Okay.
And I'm ready.
Well, we're back and we're ready for more mountain murders, right?
Yes, we are. We're very excited about it.
And today's case is, well, it's an interesting one. And there's some, disappearance involved. And we had kind of a weird situation earlier in the week, if you will, last week.
Yes.
Last couple of days, anyway. You want to tell our listeners about that?
Yeah, you disappeared in a parking lot on me. So I went into the gas station. I asked her if I was going to get a few beers and asked her if she needed anything.
Well, we go to this one particular convenience store in town that has, like, the best selection of craft beers.
Yes, they do.
So let's preface the story with that.
By far.
So we went kind of on a beer run so you could get a delicious craft beer.
Yes.
Of your choosing.
Yes, and I was like,
the array of selection.
Do you need anything? She was like, no thanks. I'm good. So I go in, I pay. Kind of, you know, the guy's going back and forth with another customer at the register. My attention was on that. So I get my stuff and I come out and car's empty. And so just immediately I'm like, okay, well, maybe she wouldn't use the bathroom. But like directly behind that thought was, what if she's been taken?
You mean like the Liam Neeson movie?
Yes. Like, yeah, I have a set of skills that make me a nightmare for people like you kind of thing, which I'm still working out what skills those are. But
well, you can eat like a pan of brownies like nobody's business. So
well, that could serve me well.
Maybe you could just show up and eat all their
brownies. Yeah.
I don't know.
So yeah, just instantly, almost instantly, I'm like, okay, well, she's probably just in the bathroom. And then I think, well, that's what people always think in these situations. Like if someone's gone, they're just like, oh, well, you know, they're just around back or whatever. And so I instantly scan the parking lot at all the tags, because even if I don't remember them, I know hypnosis might be able to bring it out later. I'm making a note of vehicles and types of clothes people are wearing, their general descriptions. And that's what was going through my mind when you came out of the door of the store.
Yeah, well, I had decided, you know, to pop on in. I was going to get something as well. Because initially I was like, oh, I don't need anything. And then I'm like, oh, you know, a drink would be good. Maybe some cider or something. And I thought you saw me when I walked in.
Yeah, which I didn't.
Yeah, well, I thought you had seen me. And so I didn't tell you I was in there, because I was like, oh, he just saw me go in, right? And I'm over at the case picking out what I want.
Yeah.
And but then when I was at the register, I was thinking, I bet he thinks something happened to me. It's like that thought went through my mind at the same time. So it's kind of funny. We're both in tune, and we need to like stop listening to so many murder podcasts.
Yeah, I think we need to take a break.
We both have a mind that immediately goes to like, we're going to be decorating a ditch.
Right.
If something happened, you know?
Yeah, I was totally ready to identify your corpse. In the 2 minutes, I didn't know where you were.
It should be pretty easy to identify.
Right.
I mean, I have a lot of tattoos.
Okay.
On this body.
Right.
I've got a third nipple.
She does.
So that's easy to find. But okay. Anyway, yeah. So we're going to get on with today's podcast, today's show.
Yeah. Fortunately, she was just in the store and she's still with me, guys. Everything's okay.
Yeah. My sciatic nerve is killing me right now, but that's about the only thing that's murdering me.
Right.
My butt hurts. Okay, so we're going to get started with this. And this is an interesting story. And as I mentioned before, it is a case that starts out with a disappearance. So something relatable as a married couple. There is a married couple here in the story. So let's get to it. So on September 7th, 1997, hunters in North Carolina's Pisgah National Forest found human bones, clothing, and some other items scattered in the woods near a campground. Now, the remains, most of which were centered around a shallow grave, so they had been buried in a very shallow grave were identified as belonging to a woman somewhere between the ages of 40 and 55. And she had a seriously arthritic knee that was noted. So she could very well be me, I suppose.
So they could tell that from the skeleton.
Yeah. Well,
okay.
I guess. Or maybe later on the autopsy. But right. Due to the holes and cuts on her bra, she had cutting marks on the bones as well. And investigators ruled pretty quickly that the unidentified deceased woman had been stabbed to death. I guess just from the initial, you know,
right.
checking this body out. So after seeing a missing persons flyer that had been sent to the area, there was an emergency room doctor over in Franklin named Dr. Parker Davis who received one of these flyers. And he noticed the description matched that of a woman found recently in the forest. So, you know, an autopsy had been performed. They were matching dental records, the arthritic knee, and that soon led the doctor to conclude that he believed this was the body of Judy Smith, a missing woman. Her husband had sent out flyers, you know, as pretty much as soon as she went missing. So they were able to identify her. She was born Judith Eldridge, December 15th, 1946, in Hyannis, Massachusetts. She was a 50-year-old nurse from Newton, Massachusetts, and she was positively seen alive by her husband, Jeffrey, at a hotel in Philadelphia almost 5 months before.
Wow.
So this is September. 5 months before, that would have been April. So what had happened, and this is kind of an interesting story, is that her husband, Jeff, was a lawyer, and they had only been married, you know, just a couple of months, maybe 8 months or something. I mean, they were practically newlyweds, if you think about it like that. And he was an attorney. He was attending a conference in Philadelphia, and his wife had never been to the city of brotherly love, so she wanted to join him in town. Pretty normal, you know, your husband's going out of town on business. You take the week off work, you join him.
Well, you're newlyweds.
A fun trip, right?
Can't stand being away from each other yet.
Right? Oh, we know what that's like. Not. So, you know, the plan was that during the day, she would do some sightseeing, and maybe in the evenings, they could spend time together. And when the two arrived at the airport in Boston, Judy had realized that she had forgotten her ID because photo identification had only been required a short time before that, you know, to board a flight. So at this point, she doesn't have her driver's license. She says she needs to go home, get her license. So she tells her husband she would go get the license. She's going to hop a later flight, meet him at the DoubleTree Hotel where they're booked in Philadelphia. So the plan goes accordingly. She arrived on the next flight. She took a cab to the hotel, and she only made one stop to buy flowers as an apology. So, you know, starting out like a typical trip out of town.
Right.
You know, the only atypical thing would have been forgetting her license, but that's not so uncommon. And so she is supposedly going sightseeing, and this case draws a lot of questions. So the morning of April 10th, Jeff got up. So this would have been April the 9th. So everything goes as planned. She flies into town, comes to the hotel, brings these flowers. I guess they go out, have dinner that evening, see some people around town, you know. So the next morning, which would have been April the 10th, Jeff got up earlier than she did, and he went downstairs at the hotel to have breakfast and comes back upstairs. He says they bantered a little bit about her not showing up for breakfast on time, you know, because she was taking a shower, and she jokes around, oh, well, you know, what am I supposed to do? Come downstairs naked, you know, that kind of thing. So he said they were having a, you know, like a, just a playful discussion. And so he asks her, you know, what are your plans for the day? Because he's going to be in a conference, you know, in meetings all day, going to workshops, that kind of thing. Well, she told him her plan was to get some tickets on a bus tour around Philadelphia, that she wanted to visit the Liberty Bell, Independence Hall, you know, Penn's Landing, all the different things that you do when you were in Philadelphia. Probably wanted to go to the art museum. Who doesn't want to go see the Rocky Balboa statue?
Right. I'd have to see that
right?
in Philly.
You have a Philly cheesesteak.
Get your car towed.
These are like pretty common things that you do when you're in Philly. Exactly. So she was going to be back around 5:30, and the plan was they were going to meet up. He had some clients that they were going to meet for cocktails, and then they were going to have a nice dinner to themselves, you know, after they had cocktails. So sounds like a typical evening, you know, with your spouse. out of town.
Yeah, sounds fun to me.
Well, by 6:15, Judy had not shown up at the hotel as planned. And so her husband got worried about her, as you would. You know, she's supposed to be home back at the hotel by 5:30. She's not there yet, you know.
You're in a strange city.
Yeah, you start to worry. But I guess he wasn't super concerned just yet because, you know, he was like, well, she's on this tour. Maybe it lasted longer. Maybe she got held up. Maybe she went shopping. I mean, you know, there's a million reasons why that maybe she wasn't on time. So he went on to have cocktails and thought, well, maybe she'll show up like downstairs at the hotel bar, wherever they were having drinks. You know, maybe she'll come later on. And so goes, has drinks with buddies, whatever, clients, and she still hasn't returned. And so he finally starts to get, you know, a little bit more concerned about all of this and discusses it with the hotel concierge and relayed what had happened. And so the concierge got the bus route where she had been and, you know, gave it to Jeff, the husband. I guess he hopped in a cab and started searching for her. So he gets in a cab, you know, goes out on the city, goes to some of these sites, thinking that maybe he'll bump into her.
Yeah, I mean, you got to imagine, freaking out at this point
like
a little bit.
This is pre-cell phone days.
Right.
I mean, 1997, people didn't really have cell phones.
No, you got to go find them.
Yeah.
Literally.
So that was kind of his plan, was that he might be able to find her. So goes out looking for her, doesn't find her, goes back to the hotel and discusses it with the hotel concierge. They began calling hospitals because, you know, that would be obviously, I guess, the next step. Calling around to make sure there hadn't been an accident or something. You know, she
wasn't back in the
hurt.
Day, you called hospitals and jails when you're looking for someone.
Well, they even went as far as phoning the bus company that offered the tour, and eventually they had to call the police. So a driver, I guess, with the tour company does remember like picking her up and dropping her off somewhere, but he didn't really have any information on whether or not she took the tour. So I guess he just sort of recognized the name or the description of this lady, knew her name. Hey, she did get on my bus, but he couldn't remember exactly if she'd completed the whole tour, kind of thing. So Jeff felt the police weren't taking the missing persons report seriously when he called. They, you know, kind of seemed stuck on this notion that maybe she'd just taken off, you know, maybe out of anger, maybe for attention.
Well, you know, they're going to suspect the spouse.
So this would have been a 1997 gone girl, like she just up and disappeared.
Right.
Trying to cause a scene kind of thing.
And that seems to happen a lot in missing person cases. And first, they say they've run off. Are you sure you didn't have a fight? Blah, blah, blah. And then next thing you know, they're going to suspect you if it turns into anything.
So, you know, they felt like at some point. So I guess at some point they felt like she was going to return after she'd made a point, you know, and not to get too strung out on the idea that she was missing. It'll all work itself out. You know, maybe it was some sort of marital problem, you know, if you will. So they weren't taking it very seriously, and it just so happens that attending the conference where her husband Jeff was, you know, participating in this, he was at this conference with Mayor Rendell and a state representative named John Purzel, and he decided, I guess, to talk to them since they were attending this conference and kind of relayed that he felt like the police weren't taking this missing persons report very seriously. So they even pulled some strings to try to get a search underway on his behalf.
So he knew somebody.
Yeah. And so the Philadelphia police initially considered Jeffrey a suspect. They cast doubt on the idea that his wife had even been to the city in the first place. And they started suggesting his story was fabricated, that she had never even been there to begin with. And, you know, of course, he was pretty upset about this. So he decided, you know, initially he didn't want to take a polygraph test by the local police department.
Right, because they're already treating him like dirt.
Well, I guess he told them that if he would take one, but only if the FBI administered this polygraph.
That and it's junk science.
Right. I mean, he just was like, well, whatever. Well, they, you know, go on the defensive automatically. He's a suspect and he's refusing to take this polygraph kind of thing.
I don't blame him a bit. So I come to the local law enforcement. My wife's missing. I don't know what's happened to her. I'm all to hell about that. And just they tell me they're not even sure if she was really in the city and they think my whole story's fabricated. That's instantly going to put you on the defense.